Are you trying to collect thousands of Google search results for your competitor analysis? Or maybe you're looking to scrape thousands of pages to monitor your website and SEO keywords? Well, then this video is for you. Having a flexible search engine scraper that can deliver accurate public data day by day and on any scale can do wonders for a business. And today it's even easier than before, since Google leads the desktop search engine market with an impressive 83% majority share. It also means that it hosts plenty of valuable data for individuals and businesses, but extracting it automatically isn't a cakewalk. Watch this video to learn about the intricacies of scraping Google search results and how to overcome them for successful projects. When dealing with search results, you can't go about your way without running into the term SERP, especially if you're new to web scraping or search engine optimization. It stands for Search Engine Results Page, which is a search engine page you get when you enter a query into the search bar. Today, Google SERPs are filled with distinct features and elements like featured snippets, paid ads, video carousel. People also ask local pack and related searches. While Google has methods to detect malicious bot activities, it also means that friendly bots, like web scrapers, have to deal with bot detection techniques as well. The first difficulty you may encounter, even by just browsing Google SERPs yourself, is captcha challenges. Captchas are designed to prevent bots from accessing websites by making it difficult for them to solve tests. Yet humans can do that with ease. When a website visitor can't complete the test after a few tries, it often leads to an IP ban. Overcoming these challenges may require you to use proxies or an advanced web scraping tool like SERP Scraper API. IP address blocks are another hurdle in the way of successful SERP scraping. There are many reasons your IP may be blocked, but most commonly, when connection requests coming from an IP address seems suspicious, websites are quick to block such IPs. Again, there are various reasons behind IP blocks, so see this related video about how to avoid IP blocks for a deeper dive into the topic. Among the obstacles of scraping SERPs, disorganized data is a challenge that needs constant monitoring. As Google is committed to providing the best user experience, its web structure and elements can change frequently, meaning that the parsing logic that worked before may become obsolete. Not to mention, it's a time-consuming hassle to set up parsing logic within the data pipeline, as the whole point of gathering data from Google is to analyze it and gain insights. For example, insights for search engine optimization, you need to have a scraping infrastructure that consistently delivers parsed SERP data that's ready for analysis. With such challenges in mind, I want to show you how easy it is to scrape Google SERPs on any scale and without any interruptions using Oxylabs Google Scraper API in Python. Also, if you're interested to learn more about web scraping, check out this related video about web scraping tips and tricks. Begin by setting up a 7-day free trial of Oxylabs Google Scraper API. It'll take you less than a minute to complete this step, so head to the Oxylabs dashboard and create an account. You can find the dashboard link in the description below. Next, install Python itself if you don't have it already, and then install the requests module. We'll use it to send HTTP requests to Google Scraper API. Open up your terminal and enter the following. Depending on your setup, you may need to use the Python 3 keyword instead, like so. Create a new Python file and start by importing the libraries. The ppprint library will allow you to print the response later in a more readable structure. Now, let's create the payload that will provide instructions to the scraper. By looking at the URL, you can see that we are requesting Google search results for the term Newton. Next, set up the response object. It'll send a POST request to the Oxylabs Google Scraper API, authenticate using your credentials, and pass the payload dictionary in JSON format. Now, what's left is to parse and print the JSON response. You can now run the code and see the output. You can see that the HTML results are within the content key. What's so neat about Oxylabs Google Scraper API is that you can parse results by adding just two words in the payload object. You don't have to use any external libraries like Beautiful Soup, LXML, or others that will require you to check HTML elements and figure out proper CSS or XPath syntax. So let's update our code. Simply add parse true within the payload. Run the code, wait for the API to finish the job, and here you can see the parsed search results. Alternatively, you can use a freely available feature of Oxylabs scraper APIs called Custom Parser. With it, you can define your own parsing logic and retrieve the data as you please. See this video for more details about Custom Parser. There are various parameters you can use to fine-tune your scraping projects. As mentioned previously, the payload dictionary is used to instruct the API about how the scraping job should be carried out. The source parameter is the most important, as it sets the scraper type to be used. The Google source will allow you to provide the Google URLs you want to scrape. Other values like Google Search, Google Ads, Google Hotels, Google Images, Google Suggest, and others offer more ways to scrape Google and also cater to specific Google page types. For more information on these parameters and their differences, visit Oxylabs documentation. Let's create a Google SERP scraper that would provide us with results localized for the German region. Here, we'll use another neat feature of Oxylabs Google Scraper API, built-in proxies. We'll also use another source value, Google Search, to scrape search results for the keyword Newton. So, open up your code editor and follow along. As the Google Search source doesn't support URL values, you have to add a key called query and combine it with a value Newton. There are several parameters that can localize results for the German region. The first one is the domain parameter, which, for example, when coupled with a value DE, will fetch results from the google.de domain. The second parameter is locale, which will set the interface language of the Google search page. And the third parameter, called geolocation, will make the API run requests through a proxy server located in the specified country and or use Google's own content localization capabilities. There are four ways you can fine-tune the results with the geolocation parameter. Visit the documentation for more detail. But for this tutorial, let's use a country name. I'll add the parse-through parameter as well. Now with this payload, you can extract parsed Google search results in American English from the google.de domain and do it all through a physically located proxy in Germany. The results look just like a real user in Germany would see. By default, Google Scraper API will return the first 10 search results from the first page. There are three parameters you can use to control the number of results. The start page parameter determines the starting page number. So add this key and set it to start from the first page. As much as I like Newton, shoes are perhaps more popular, so let's also change the query value here to shoes to see different results. Then the pages parameter sets the number of pages to scrape. So for this tutorial, let's set it to the total number of 5 pages. And the limit parameter controls the number of search results to retrieve from each page. So let's say we want to see 10 results for each page. So now our payload will instruct the API to start scraping from the first search results page and retrieve a total of 5 pages with the first 10 results from each page. To add more control, you can use the context parameter. So visit the documentation if you want to see how that can be done. Let's run this code and see the results. When it comes to saving the scraped data to CSV, there are two ways you can do that. The first method uses the pandas library. Start by installing it in the terminal. Or depending on your setup, you can use the pip3 command in the same manner. Then import the library. Next, create a data object. And then use this object to get the results, normalize JSON, and save everything into a CSV file. This method may still provide some cells that contain an array of JSON elements, as you can see. Thus, you may need to customize this code. Another much easier way that doesn't use pandas at all is to send a GET request to another Oxylabs endpoint to retrieve normalized CSV data. Let's add a few more lines of code to fetch the job ID from the original response. Then, make a new request to retrieve normalized data in CSV format and save it into a CSV file. I'm using Google Sheets to view the file, and as you can see, the CSV file is easy to read and has all the scraped data. When scraping Google search results, you may have to deal with network issues, invalid query parameters, or API quota limits. These challenges can be handled by using try-except blocks in your code. For instance, if an error occurs when sending an API request, you can catch it by adjusting the code like this. When you send an invalid parameter, Google Scraper API will return a 400 response code. For such errors, you can use an if statement to check the status code. So, Google Scraper API is powerful yet easy to use. You can effortlessly create scalable projects and collect accurate and highly localized search results. If you found this video helpful, like and subscribe, and we hope to see you next time. Thanks for watching.